Good morning, everyone. Today I'm presenting a case of patient, a 29-year-old male, Mr. Amit Kumar, worker by occupation, residing at Alwar, Rajasthan, admitted for definitive surgery. History of present illness. Patient was apparently normal 1.5 month ago, 7 month ago. Then he had alleged history of ingestion of acid Harpic, approx 20 ml with suicidal intent. On 23rd of May 2021. Following this, patient had retrosternal burning sensation and multiple episodes of non-bilious vomiting 10 minutes following oral liquid intake. No history of any odynophagia, dysphagia, drooling of saliva, hematemesis, stridor, hoarseness of voice, coughing, respiratory distress was there at that time. At that time, patient was admitted in some hospital in periphery, kept NPO for 2 days and then started on oral liquids and discharged with liquid diet. In that admission settings, no upper GI endoscopy was done, no imaging was done, sir. 15 days after discharge, patient developed complaint of postprandial vomiting after solid or liquid ingestion, for which patient was advised to take liquid diet only, but as patient remained symptomatic, one upper GI endoscopy was done and managed with IV fluids and referred to higher center. At that time, patient had no history of any dysphagia, colic, abdominal pain, distension, any bowel rolling sensation, any borborygmia. Patient was admitted to our center and after upper GI scopy, barium swallow underwent feeding jejunostomy on 6th of operative course and discharge on 13th of July with advice and training of 2.5 liter FJ feed per day. In last 5 months, patient had lost almost 26 kgs of weight despite FJ feed, though patient is well preserved. At present, patient is having complaint of postprandial vomiting only, sir. History, past history, no medical comorbidities, no any psychiatric illness, no past history suggestive of previous suicidal tendency. Feeding jejunostomy was done on 7th of July 2021. In personal history, patient is on mixed diet, unaltered bladder bowel habit, history of alcohol consumption for 4 years daily, tobacco chewing since last 6 years, and no other substance abuse. No significant family history, sir. So, should I summarize my history, sir?
Yes, give a summary.
Yes, so 25-year-old male with history of acid ingestion 7 months ago, copy and barium swallow, followed by feeding jejunostomy 1.5 month later than the acid ingestion, presented with complaint of postprandial vomiting for definitive surgery. My provisional diagnosis is, sir, corrosive injury of stomach, mostly type 1 or type 2 gastric corrosive strictures, sir.
Ramesh, can I ask you a question? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you have to also say that he has no symptoms of difficulty in swallowing. Alright?
Yes, sir.
So that from history itself we know the extent of esophageal involvement, if at all, is minimal. Right?
Yes, sir.
You haven't mentioned that. And one other thing I'd like to say for this Harpic. The Harpic toilet cleaner is acid and the Harpic floor cleaner is alkaline. So when they tell you Harpic, you have to inquire what it is actually in the day.
Hello, hello, I think this is a manage for letting.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, the thing is, you have to specify whether the esophageal symptoms are there and also what type of Harpic he ingested. Because Harpic can be both alkaline and acid. Right?
Acidic Harpic, sir.
Yeah, the toilet cleaner is acid and the floor cleaner Harpic is alkaline.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
sir. So that has to be specified. And what type of jejunostomy was it? Minimal access or open? If it's open, did they look at the stomach? That also you have to mention.
Sir, open feeding jejunostomy was done, sir, with upper midline small
yeah,
incision.
So any mention
at that
of
time, stomach was supple, sir.
Supple is all right, but any abnormality seen from outside? If it is not mentioned, it's not mentioned, but you say it is not mentioned.
Okay, sir.
Can I ask?
Yes, please, Vikas.
Yeah. So, what kind of abnormalities can you anticipate in the early phase? What are the changes which you can anticipate while doing laparotomy or laparoscopy in stomach in a patient with carosis?
So, in early phase, sir, in immediate phase, there could be so perforation if amount. Of intake is
no. We are talking in context with this patient. This patient had no perforation. It was just for a nutrition purpose. Feeding jejunostomy was done.
Yes, sir.
You see, students, you must listen to the question very carefully. And in clinical exam, most of the questions are related to this case. There will be few theoretical questions, but most of the questions will be related to this case. So when Dr. Anant Krishnan and Dr. Vikas asked you that how the jejunostomy was done, at that time was the stomach examined. Now you have to tell us the operative findings which you can see or which you may see at 15 days after a corrosive injury. So don't go to perforation and all. That is earlier. We have already done a barium and endoscopy. So obviously there is no perforation. Then only we have taken the patient for feeding jejunostomy. So you must listen to the question carefully, give a pause, think about what the examiner wants to know and ask, and then answer. Yes. So what changes do you expect to see when you do a laparoscopy or laparotomy at 15 days to do a feeding jejunostomy in a patient like this?
So there could be some inflammation of stomach. There could be thickening of the wall of the stomach.
Can it follow some pattern? So in corrosive, what are the patterns of gastric involvement you can see?
Sorry, sir, your voice is breaking, sir.
In a corrosive injury of stomach, what are the patterns of involvement you can see? So based on those patterns, can you identify the early changes?
Yes, sir. Acute inflammation phase, then granulation phase, and after that, after 3 weeks of injury, there is cicatrization or fibrosis phase.
Yes, yeah, so based on those extent of injury, can you see a pattern? If you want to see if its stricture is formed, what is the most likely site of stricture? And at that particular point during acute phase, will you like to examine that area?
Yes, sir. In
I think because you can maybe provide the answer.
Yeah. So see, there can either be a stricture which will be just proximal to the pylorus. So you specifically should look at that area for inflammation, thickening, and cicatrization. Though it will not be there in so early. Or the other pattern of involvement will be diffuse gastric involvement, where the stomach will be small capacity later on. So you should know, record the pattern of involvement and extent of involvement of the stomach. So it helps you in further planning the management. So you can go ahead.
In your summary, you did not mention the intent of ingestion. Was it accidental or suicidal? Isn't that important? You mentioned it in the history, I think, but when you summarize, you didn't mention, and in a patient with corrosive injury, that's very important as far as the overall management of the patient is concerned.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
Then you mentioned some, go to your previous slide. Yes, this one. So, no, next one. Yes. Any specific reason that you mentioned this negative history of colicky abdominal pain, distension, ball rolling, and borborygmia? These are all symptoms to suggest intestinal obstruction.
Yes, sir. Sir, if corrosive passes beyond the stomach, sir, there could be small bowel injury. So, to rule out the if small bowel injury is there or not, sir, I have asked these questions, sir.
I don't know how common or how frequent.
How often will you get small bowel injury without gastric?
I just did 20 ml.
20 ml?
Yes, sir. If amount is higher, sir, in that case...
No, no, there is no question of amount is higher. You said 20 ml ingestion. Is it not?
Yes, sir. In 20 ml, it is not. It is not.
So, if you tell irrelevant symptoms, the discussion will go in directions which you do not want. Is it not?
Yes.
So, be specific in what you are telling, which is relevant at the postgraduate.
Now, in this case,
small bowel injury has been reported only in those who have previously had a gastric bypass with small volumes.
Yes.
Why is it so that the corrosive doesn't go beyond the pylorus?
Sir, as corrosive reaches stomach, sir, there is instant pyloric spasm is there, sir.
Yeah, so corrosive intense pyloric spasm. And yes, that sir. Is why small bowel injury is very, very unlikely.
Very unlikely.
Now, in this patient, you mentioned in that admission setting when he was admitted for the acute injury, no upper GI endoscopy was done. If you were the treating physician, what would you have done? Do you agree with this management?
No, sir. I won't be agree with this management, sir. If a corrosive injury patient presented to me, I would like to perform upper GI endoscopy within 72 hours for this patient, sir, to rule out the extent of injury and plan my further management according to that, sir.
Can I say something, Vinay?
Yes, please, sir.
See, this 72 hours is gone on for a long time in books and outside. But if you have done a lot of this, you will realize very early if you do, everything is red. And even the transmural extent is difficult to assess because of the redness and the edema. This has been recommended because of the safety and the possibility of perforation when you do it little later. But then when you do it so early, you will realize that you always have to repeat it in order to get a true extent sometime later. So, even if you wait for a few days or 5 to 7 days and do it under vision without undue distension, you can safely do an endoscopy at 7 to 10 days and get a better idea of the extent and depth rather than one which is done 24 hours or 48 hours later. So, we have to move away from some of the information in books because of what we find in real life.
Also, you must, because as soon as you say you would have done an endoscopy, my next question will be, do you do your routine upper GI endoscopies in the elective setting? How many endoscopies have you done? How much is your experience? Because this endoscopy has to be done by an experienced endoscopist. And that also with extreme caution and care, with, as Dr. Anandakrishnan said, minimal insufflation. So rather than saying, I would have done the endoscopy, you should have said, if I have the help and expertise of an experienced endoscopist, I probably would have gotten upper GI endoscopy done. It has to be done very carefully and cautiously. But why do you want to assess the extent of injury at this stage? How does it matter? You said and actually the correct word is not rule out extent of injury. It is to find out the extent of.
Yes, sir. To grade the injury of corrosive ingestion.
So, how is the grading important? How does it matter whether what grade it is? We will come to the grades little later.
Bhuvanesh.
Yes, sir.
See, this philosophy was before the days of good contrast CT, right?
Okay.
When endoscopy was the best method of assessing depth and being ready for perforation or being sure that there is likelihood of perforation. If you see evidence of deep burn. But nowadays, with very good contrast CTs, you have a very good extent of depth and very visceral involvement, even with CT without having to do endoscopy to assess the depth. Intramural gas or edema, periesophageal, perigastric edema, or evidence of adhesions as seen by this image. So, those are as good as endoscopy, and therefore the value of early endoscopy has declined with very good imaging.
But following on my question, how does the Saurabh, please put your microphone off. Saurabh Sagar, please put your
sorry, investigation on. Purani patient se le le aur wo.
So how does it matter? Oh, great detail. How does it matter? Why do you want to know the grade?
According to grading, next sir, I can.
Yes.
According to grading, sir, I can start the oral feed to the patient, and I can plan further management according to grading, sir.
So one is that you can decide whether to feed the patient, when to feed the patient, or not to feed the patient. Anything else?
Yes.
Any other advantage of knowing the severity of injury?
For sir, further future planning of the management, sir.
How does it? Future management will depend on whether a stricture forms later or not. The yes. other advantage is that if it is a severe injury where you anticipate that you will not allow oral feeding, then you can plan for an early feeding port.
Feeding, yes, sir.
So I think these are the two, and of course the prognostication of the outcome. So, a lot of people, as Dr. Anantakrishnan said, two things. One, a lot of people don't believe in this philosophy. They say it doesn't matter. We will see what happens rather than risking the patient to a very precarious endoscopy. And second, with good contrast and non-CT with oral contrast, you can get the information about perforation, about the extent of transmural injury, whether there is periesophageal injury or not, which will tell you the severity of injury. Now, quickly, what is the grading of corrosive injury?
Sir, according to Jarger's grading, sir, grade 1 is sir, superficial erythema or edema is there. In grade 2A and grade 2B, sir, superficial ulceration, and grade 2B is deep ulceration. In grade 3 is divided 3A and 3B. In 3A, scattered necrosis is there, and in grade 3B is generalized necrosis is there, and grade 4 is a perforation. In
esophagus. Yeah, I'm not sure. Maybe Dr. Vikas or Dr. Anantakrishnan can say whether what he said is correct.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
Shall we carry on?
Can I ask a question further?
Yes, please.
So, is there any correlation of grading of injury with acute complication and chronic long-term complication? That is another importance of grading which you need to emphasize. So, or in other words, what is the incidence of stricture formation in various grades of injury? And what is the incidence of perforation and gangrene in various grades of injury?
Sir, I'm not aware of the actual incidence rate, but as we in grade 4 injuries, chances of perforation are very high. And in grade 4,
when you say it's already perforated, then there is no question of perforation, chances of perforation. What we need to know is grade 2, grade 3 and grade 3B, they are precarious.
Yes.
And what is the incidence of stricture formation?
Sir, in grade 2B and 3A, sir, stricture formation is almost a 50%. In grade 3B, sir, definitive stricture formation would be there.
50%. Did you read Zargar's original article?
Sorry, sir.
Because based on stricture formation, this grading was it was advocated because based on that stricture formation. So with grade 2B, the stricture formation is about 20-30%. And grade 3A, it's about 50-60% stricture formation. And 3B will be universal stricture formation. Yes. So we can go ahead, sir.
Yes, please go ahead, Bhuvnesh, with the examination.
So on examination, sir, my patient is conscious, cooperative, well-oriented, timeless in person, moderately built and moderately nourished, with BMI 22.84 kilogram per meter square, well hydrated, lying comfortably in bed, afebrile, pulse rate 76 per minute, बीपी 116 पर 74 रेस्पिरेटरी रेट 18 पर मिनट इकोग स्कोर 1 सर नो पेलर एक्ट्रस साइनोसिस क्लबिंग लिम्फेडेनोपैथी और पेडल एडिमा ब्रेथ होल्डिंग टाइम वाज 25 सेकंड्स सर ऑन ओरल कैविटी एग्जामिनेशन माउथ ओपनिंग वाज 3 फिंगर माउथ ओपनिंग इज देयर नो म्यूकोसल एरिथमा एडिमा एस्कार डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ म्यूकोसा नोटेड टोबैको स्टेनिंग ओवर टीथ नोटेड सर नॉर्मल टंग मूवमेंट इज देयर सर In abdominal examination on inspection, flat abdomen, umbilicus centrally placed, all quadrants moving equal with respiration. Previous upper midline surgical scar noted with FG tube in left upper quadrant. No visible peristalsis, no visible lump, sinus, Engel's veins, pulsation or cuff impulse. Groin hernial sites are normal and genitalia is normal, sir. On palpation, abdomen is soft, non-tender, liver not palpable, no other palpable lump, no organomegaly noted. No cuff impulse on groin hernial sites are, sir. No renal anger tenderness is there, sir. Upper border of liver dullness in fifth intercostal space, liver span 14 cm, sir. On respiratory examination, it's almost normal, sir.
Any comment, Dr. Anandkrishnan, Dr. Vikas, or shall we move on?
All these investigations have benefited you in planning management?
Sorry, sir?
In what way have all these investment values been useful in planning further management?
Sure, for the investigations, right?
Which ones are relevant, yes. Which is not relevant, and how does it influence your way of thinking?
Sir, hemoglobin was 13.2, WBC count 7000. So, sir, it suggests patient is good at nutrition, sir.
Does it mean that he's got an extracellular contraction also? Because he's vomiting and your jejunostomy is not enough.
Sir, he's getting feeding 2.5 liter feed per day, sir. And there is no electrolyte imbalance from KFT and creatinine is normal, sir. So, it suggests that there is no extracellular contraction, sir. It seems it is okay, sir.
It's truly representative of his hemoglobin. UK.
Yes, sir. I feel like.
All right. Then?
Then, sir.
Please, go ahead.
Then, sir, patient serum albumin is 4.9 gram per deciliter. So, sir, if we are planning some definitive surgery, albumin is also good, sir. We can perform surgery with this albumin, sir.
So, can you make a comment, sir?
Yeah, you should say that in my assessment, based on clinical exam, because you see, you said he has lost significant weight, which was worrying. We didn't discuss that, but it was worrying. But these investigations, you should say, suggest that in spite of that, I think his nutritional status, which is reflected by his hemoglobin and serum albumin, is reasonably good so that I can plan the definitive surgery at this point in time.
So, can I make a comment?
Yeah. Yes, please.
So, in your clinical examination before going on to investigation, you didn't mention anything about the nutritional assessment of this patient, BMI, because these patients, they are quite nutritionally depleted, and any evidence of vitamin deficiency, you need to mention specifically on these patients because they are from oral feeds. So what is this ECOG status? Is this BMI? Is this? So what are the other nutritional assessments will you like to do in this patient?
Sir, for nutritional assessment, I'll look for sir if there is. Subcutaneous fat pad is there or not, sir? Buccal fat pad, occipital fat, then sir, triceps full thickness, sir, midarm circumference.
If you know about all these things, you need to record and tell the examiner that okay, you have specifically looked into it.
See, two things. One, in the exam, nothing is understood. You get marks for what you say. We can read into your mind, but we don't give you marks for that, number one. Number two, since your exam may still be online mode, when you are given a case capsule, whatever is not there, you have to say that I want to know about this. You can't just mention what is mentioned on the case summary. So you have to say that I would like to know about this, 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 this. That tells us that you know more about what we are asking. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is a situation where your nutritional general physical examination has to be more detailed rather than in any other case.
Just one point I want to add, Ronesh. You yes, said sir. All the signs and symptoms of fat loss, but equally important is sarcopenia, is it not?
Yes.
In these patients. And all that you said may not reflect sarcopenia. So we have to do bedside tests like hand grip, dynamometry. Because that also affects the complication rate and that has an effect on the ECOG score. By the way, what does ECOG stand for?
What is ECOG? Again,
don't mention these abbreviations, any term which you don't know about.
You should know.
What is ECOG?
Sir, European criteria of oncology.
No, there are no criteria there.
He is not European here.
This is Eastern Cooperative Oncology Group. Okay. So it was initially devised for patients with malignancy, but now we have started using it even in non-cancer patients to assess the performance status. Is there an alternative to this?
Sir, WHO criteria is also alternative to this, sir.
For performance status?
Yes, sir. WHO criteria for performance status.
I'm not sure. Is he right, Vikas? Yes, this is the other commonly used performance status.
That is more commonly used.
It starts with K.
Karnofsky score, sir.
So these are the two common. I don't know about WHO, so maybe you are right, but just check. And but these are the two common performance status scores or scales which are used. Okay. Okay, carry on. So you have those blood investigations. What next you want to do now?
Sir, I want to look for the upper GI endoscopy which was performed earlier and if any upper GI endoscopy performed at present.
Why are you bothered about what was done earlier? Would you not like to do one now? That has been weeks ago, is it not?
Yes, sir. I would like to know the recent one also, but sir, first of all, I would like to know the prior one so I can see the changes which have occurred in this 7th month duration. So,
do you think there has been no progression based on symptoms?
Yes, sir.
Then, why do we have to look at the endoscopy previously?
You see, that endoscopy was done very early after the injury, isn't it? I think just 2 or 3 days after the injury.
Almost 1 month, sir. 1 month after.
The injury. 1 month. 1 month. Yes, but sir. still, the question which Dr. Anand Krishnan wants to know from you is, how does that endoscopy help you in deciding the management now? Suppose there is no other endoscopy. Suppose that is the only endoscopy. Based on that, can you decide the management today?
No, sir. I'll perform the...
So this is what we are trying to say, that in a case like this, where almost 5 or 6 months have elapsed, you have to have a recent evaluation to see the present status, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that endoscopy probably is not of much use at the moment to decide the definitive treatment. Okay?
Yes.
But anyway, let us look at the endoscopy.
Sir, this was upper GI endoscopy performed on 20th of June, which shows stomach reducing capacity with diffuse superficial ulcer, bleed on touch, narrowing in pylorus and scope not negotiable, sir. In this endoscopy, they haven't mentioned about the status of esophagus. So, I would like to know the status of esophagus also in this endoscopy, sir.
What is your assessment? What do you think about the esophagus at this point in time, June 20th?
Sir, with this endoscopy and symptomatology of patient, esophagus seems normal, sir.
Yeah, so probably not spared.
Yes, sir. Spared.
Okay. So,
the very fact that they have been able to negotiate a normal endoscope into the stomach, that is an indirect evidence that esophagus should be normal.
Because you want to say something?
Yeah, man, what I was saying, the very fact that they have been able to negotiate an adult endoscope into the stomach, so we can assume that esophagus and cricopharynx, cricopharynx is very important to mention when you are doing upper GI scopy. So both these things will be normal.
So you want to repeat an endoscopy now?
Yes, sir.
Endoscopy first or a contrast study first?
Sir, at present,
both,
sir,
or you want to do one?
At present, I want to do both, sir.
Why both?
Sir, with endoscopy, if is there any active mucosal ulceration process is going or not inside the stomach, I would like to know that. And with contrast study, I want to look for the status of distensibility of stomach, involvement of stomach, sir.
So you mean to say on endoscopy you cannot make out the distensibility of the stomach? You said that on contrast you would like to see the distensibility, which means that you are trying to say that on endoscopy you cannot, but that is not correct.
Yeah.
On endoscopy you can distend the stomach and see whether stomach is distending or not, so that is not a correct statement. Okay,
and it is done as a matter of fact. They always, I mean, they have to distend the stomach to see if they are examining the stomach, and then only they will immediately come to know that it is distensible or not distensible.
So, Dr. Ankrishnan, for the benefit of students, at this stage, what investigation should we do, both? And if both, then in what sequence?
I would probably do endoscopy first. And if I have enough information on endoscopy, I may not do a contrast study because it's not going to add much information by way of planning.
Vikas, what will be your approach?
So I will do endoscopy to have a look at the upper esophagopharyngeal junction. I will have a look at the esophagus. I will see the whole stomach, which is not mentioned here. I will see mucosa, whether it is still ulcerated, which means that fibrosis is likely to be progressive, or it is completely epithelialized. And I will see where the narrowing is and what is the extent of narrowing proximally. Distally, of course, I may not be able to see because not being able to pass. And if then I have a suspicion that it may be extending into the duodenum, I would probably do a CCT contrast rather than a oral barium contrast, barium mean.
Sir, a frequent question which we ask the students as examiners in the exam is that what is the time at which we say that the fibrotic process has kind of reached its maximum and then we can plan definitive surgery? I find students not very clear.
Yeah.
So, would you like to?
I would never like to operate, this is my personal view, never like to operate before 6 months because that is the stage of maximum fibrosis. But I have seen in some patients fibrosis going on up to 1 year, and I have also reported what we call delayed gastric outlet obstruction, where it has happened even before, after 1 year, following an esophageal substitution when previously the stomach looked normal. So I think
minimum
best time is not to do anything before 6 months and because take it as it comes after that.
Yeah.
Depending
because
on
would you also do the same?
Yeah, I will agree with what Dr. Anand Krishnan says, and we have also reported that after doing a gastrectomy, about 10% incidence of delayed esophageal stricture formation subsequently, and those strictures, a few of them required the reoperative intervention. So when gastrectomy is done and doing a reoperative intervention in that situation becomes a really difficult job.
Well, students, 6 months is the bare minimum, and that is what I also practice and teach, that you have to wait for minimum 6 months before you plan any definitive treatment. And as Dr. Anand Krishnan said, that on your endoscopy, if you see still active ulceration, that means that you can still have more fibrosis, and this is one situation where you may want to wait little more. So that is why endoscopy is the first investigation, because it gives you more and more important information. And in fact, in some cases, a contrast study may not even be required if endoscopy gives you the complete information. Okay. So do we have a recent endoscopy in this patient?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yeah. Please.
this endoscopy suggestive of esophagus normal mucosa G junction at 40 centimeter. Stomach is having decreased volume and reduced distensibility, noted sir. Fundus scarred friable mucosa, body scarred mucosa, enterum scarred mucosa, and pyloric stenosis is there, sir. D1 and D2 is not seen, sir. So, from yes, this end,
yes, this is the point which Dr. Anand Krishnan was saying. Now, you don't see any active, although in the pictures it appears that there are some active ulcers, but in the description they have not sent. So, which may indirectly tell you that probably the healing and fibrotic process has reached its maximum.
Fundus scores scarred and friable. Friability indicates that it is still not completely
healed. It not reached friability.
Yes.
Yeah. I think so, the second picture.
And it, we can see the ulcers in the second picture from the top.
Yes.
Another characteristic thing, you see the sacculations. That's because of irregular fibrotic bands.
Again seen in the second picture. Okay, so in this case, the barium contrast study was also done. Let us look at that.
So, this is barium contrast study, barium swallow.
How do you know it is barium? By so, looking at the film, can you say whether it is barium or gastrographin?
It is a contrast study, sir. So
yeah, I don't think, I don't know whether a radiologist can make out, but I don't think I can make out whether it is barium or gastrographin. So just say contrast.
Contrast study showing, sir, bilateral lungs are normal, sir, with esophagus. Contrast going through the esophagus, there is no definitive stricture noted in esophagus. LES junction is mightily contracted, sir. With contrast going easily in stomach and contrast not passing in duodenum, sir.
No. Please comment on the first film. Are you happy at the way the esophagus is emptying?
No, sir, there is some irregularity at LES is noted, sir.
Yes, and then there's a fluid level in the proximal stomach, is it not?
Yes.
And then it's trickling down into the distal stomach.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Which you can see better in the third film.
Yes, sir.
And here also in the third film, still at the lower end of the esophagus, there's a suspicious area. It may be all right for the scope to be pushed through, but whether that is going to go to stricture later on, we have to be very seriously concerned.
Yes, sir.
But sir, may I ask that based on this, would you go ahead with dealing with the stomach, or would you still wait for the esophagus to mature?
You're asking me or asking him?
No, for the benefit of students, if you could.
I would probably wait.
Even though the scope has passed?
Yes, I would probably wait.
Okay, because?
Because if the nutrition is adequate, I am not really bothered about delaying the surgery.
Okay. Because what would be your approach?
I will will go ahead and take out some part of the abdominal esophagus and anastomose it close to the hiatus rather than waiting the surgery, because it's already 6 months and it's a short segment stricture. We can tackle it through the abdomen itself. Yes, if I had this thing in the mid esophagus, then we would I would have waited for some more time. Yes.
So, of course, we will go into what surgery, but your approach would be to excise the lower esophagus also.
Okay. Yeah.
I think we will discuss that little later. Yeah. Now, the second thing, Bhuvnesh, when you read the stomach, you didn't tell us much about the stomach. Here, main pathology is in the stomach. You just said the duodenum is not seen. Is that all? Do you see the entire stomach?
No, sir. I haven't seen the entire stomach. Sir, stomach is also...
Please describe it again in more detail.
So, contrast is going in stomach. Stomach seems contracted with... contrast is not passing through pylorus and duodenum. So, sir, pyloric stricture with enteral stricture is.
Is that the normal position of the pylorus?
No, sir.
So, which means that the stomach is shortened, contracted.
Yes, sir. Contracted, yes, sir.
Isn't it?
Yes.
So, what happens to the pylorus? Where did the pylorus go?
That being discharged, that poly old
age. Venkatesh, please put your microphone off. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir. Sir was asking about something.
Yeah, so we were asking you about the normal position of pylorus. Do you see the position, the pylorus in this case in the normal position?
No, sir. Pylorus is on the left side. Sir, pylorus.
So, which means that the stomach has contracted.
Contracted, yes, sir.
And the pull the
gastroduodenal junction to the yes. left.
Yes, sir.
Just for the sake of completion of reading a film, you see something else in the film? Any foreign body? In the fifth?
Yes, in the sixth, sir, there is a tube noted.
We all know that it is there because we know. But again, for the sake of completion, and you should mention, just as you mentioned the chest, which was very good, lungs. Lung fields, yes. Which was a very good observation, but at the same time, you should probably do this, okay?
Yes.
And so, in the stomach film, again, you can see some what endoscopists, in endoscopy, we could see circulation. There is some circulation and some outpouching and pseudodiverticular formation. The border of the upper border of the fundus is irregular. Yes, so, these are the small, subtle findings you need to mention when you are reading a film. Might not be clinically very significant, but again, these are the findings you need to note down.
Can you see that in the third film on the
yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
The border
yes,
of
sir.
The fundus?
Yes,
yes,
sir. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Pseudo-diverticuli because of fibrosis in the mucosa.
And that is in consonance with the this endoscopic finding. You saw Professor told that there are circulations in the fundus, and that is what that fundus is being seen in this. There were circulations, there were ulcerations, there were frivolity.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what is your plan of management of this young man at this stage? Any other investigation you want?
No, sir. These investigations are sufficient for me, sir.
We talked about contrast enhanced CT scan. You want that? We haven't done that.
But sir, this upper GI endoscopy and this contrast study, they tell very perfectly about the disease.
Again, a very common mistake. When a question is asked, give the answer first. I asked you, do you want a contrast enhanced CT or no? You should say, no, I don't want. Then give the reason.
Okay, sir. No, sir. I don't want, sir.
Yeah. So, Dr. Vikas, to the students, can you tell whether there is any role in place of contrast CT at this stage, say a few months or 6 months or 1 year after the corrosion?
Yeah, sir. In fact, endoscopy and barium, that has delineated the morphology fairly adequately. So, I don't think CT should be required at this stage. We should take this patient for definitive reconstruction.
Dr. Anand Krishnan, any other point in favor of a CT at this stage, at 6 months?
Not at this stage. We have enough information to plan.
Yeah. Okay. So, Bhuvnesh, what is your plan of management of this young man?
Sir, though patient have lost weight, but patient is well preserved and patient is already...
Again.
See, how can you have contrasting things? He has lost weight and is well preserved at the same time. Is it possible?
I didn't ask you all this. I said, what is your plan of management? So, the plan of management could be, I will
continue with SJP.
Now, continue. Or I will wait. First, tell me, what is your plan?
I will wait and continue with FJ feed, sir.
How long? Why do you want to wait?
You first give me reason, why will you wait?
Bhuvnesh, tell us, what is the advantage of doing now and what is the advantage of doing later? So that we justify your answer. Why you want to wait? Because Vikas said he'd like to operate. Is it not?
Sir, Yes, corrosive injury is a progressive fibrosing disease, sir. So, from this picture, I have seen this
esophageal. There's some background conversation.
Hello? Yes, sir.
Hello.
Can we?
Alias irregularities. Alias is there.
No, Bonesh, your answer, like Vinay says, should be crisp and clear. You know, if you ask me why you want to delay, my answer will be I want to delay because I suspect lower esophageal involvement. At present, it looks limited, but it may be progressive and extend beyond the area where I resect. And therefore, I want to be sure that everything is normal before I go and resect. The other answer may be the esophagus is not really structured. It is the anatomy of the displaced stomach which is causing that picture, and therefore if the endoscopy remains normal and the proximal stomach heals, I may be able to preserve some stomach for the purpose of serving as a reservoir, because the morbidity and the long-term results are better with preserved stomach rather than a esophagoentric anastomosis as far as nutrition goes. So you have to tell like that. See, you cannot tell a story. You have to be very specific.
So, students, again, in most of the situations, there will be no one definite answer or no one definite option which everybody will agree. So, you have to, if there are more than one options, you have to discuss them, and then you have to describe their pros and cons, and then you have to choose one and you have to give the reason why you would do it. Like in this case, One of us may say, I would like to wait. The other may say, I would like to operate. But you have to know the reasons for and against both the options. That is what we want in the discussion at this level of examination. So what are the reasons for waiting? Dr. Anand Krishnan has already told you. One, I could add that patient has had significant weight loss in spite of being on FJ feeds, although his nutritional parameters seem to be all right. The other reason is the doubt about the lower end of the esophagus, which you want to see for some more time and see whether it remains normal or it evolves into a stricture. Whereas there could be arguments for operating now, as Dr. Vikas said, that if you want to be radical, you can take that part of esophagus also. Somebody may say, no, I will leave that because at the moment scope is passing. So even if it forms a stricture, it will be a dilatable stricture which can be handled endoscopically, may not require surgical intervention. The reason for operating now could be that although he has lost weight, but his hemoglobin and his serum albumin and his other nutritional parameters, clinical parameters are within acceptable limit. So I don't want to wait any further. Basically, it should be an intellectual discussion between the examiners and you. This is not an MBBS or MS exam where we ask you a question and you give an answer and we give you marks. It has to be a discussion. Okay?
Yes.
Vikas, what would be your approach?
So I will consider doing a total gastrectomy because the stomach, proximal stomach, is also quite scarred and the mucosa is completely nearly destroyed. So retaining this mucosa, I am not very sure how much functionality will it give to the patient subsequently. So my approach will be to do a total gastrectomy and maybe excise lower end of the esophagus and do a esophagoenteric anastomosis.
And you would operate now?
Yeah, I will like to operate. It's already nearly 6 months downstream, so I would like to operate.
Okay. So you see, Bhuvnesh, how there could be two different aspects or options in the same situation, but you have to give justification for what you want to do, and you have to justify it.
Because in medicine, postgraduate exam, any answer is acceptable if you justify it. You see, you don't have to have only one answer.
Yes, yes. Okay, so suppose you decide to operate now, what will you do?
Sir, I'll go with, as Dr. Vikas sir said, I'll go for total gastrectomy with lower esophageal resection and esophagoenteric anastomosis.
Okay, I'll ask you one question, Bhuvnesh.
Yes, sir.
Since the fact that there is still ulceration, which means that the epithelialization healing is not complete.
Yes, sir.
After you do a total gastrectomy and the esophagovaginal, if you get a stricture there, what will be your plan of management?
It's dead.
esophageal anastomosis stricture, sir.
Because of progressive fibrosis or progressive involvement of the esophagus. What looks normal now is also strictures. Because there is only a limited amount of esophagus you can excise by the abdominal root.
Yes. So, sir, I'll advise this patient for endoscopies and endoscopically dilatation for sir esophageal strictures.
So, if it happens, that should be one approach.
Yes, sir.
But so sometimes these things don't become stable after dilatation.
So you should say that the one of the disadvantage of operating now, whether you resect the esophagus or don't resect the esophagus, is that the patient may develop recurrent dysphagia because of stricture, and that is one of the disadvantage of an early or surgery now. Okay, so is that the only surgical option? There is no other option? Why did you choose this?
Sir, there is another option, sir. We can do a distal gastrectomy and ruin by gastrojejunostomy, and we can wait for this under surveillance, this lower esophageal constriction which is there, sir.
Would you like to boost distal gastrectomy and because this patient has his whole fundus, because that is the part you are going to leave in the, and his whole fundus is still friable, showing sacculations, and radiologically there are some thing, you can see some diverticulas. I mean, is this stomach good for anastomosis?
Sir, it is in fundus part, sir. Distal part is mostly cicatrized, sir. In distal part, in endoscopic picture, I haven't seen any active ulceration, sir, which can be anastomosis, sir. And as it is diseased stomach, sir, we can spare some amount of stomach and we can put this patient for further surveillance, sir. If disease progress, we can plan our surgery later accordingly, sir.
So, you seem to have two options, and why you have selected total gastrectomy as the first option?
Because, sir, it is an active disease, it might progress, sir.
So then where, prevent of the second option? Both cannot be corrected.
You have to take one choice. You see, as Professor Kapoor told you, that this is your practical exam. Yes, your theoretical knowledge is important and it will be utilized during the course of the time, but when you are talking at this juncture, it is pertaining to this particular patient.
See,
all the questions are pertaining to this specific patient.
Yes, sir.
You will have to talk to the patient and get informed consent, is it not? What will you tell him? Will you tell him, I can remove your whole stomach, or I can remove part of your stomach and wait and it does not fibrose again? See, this is at that level that you have to put yourself in answering.
Yes, sir.
So, I think since we are nearing 10, I'll request Dr. Anand, my colleague, to tell what we did and why we did that.
Good morning, sir. So, we operated this patient yesterday, sir. And intraoperatively, what we did, we insufflate the stomach with air, which was rice tube was placed in preoperatively. With the insufflation, we can find the stomach is distended, but not very well. So what we did subtotal gastrectomy. So we leave a part of some fundus and proximal stomach, and we examine the mucosa. Mucosa was looks healthy. So we did a subtotal gastrectomy with Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy.
Esophagus was all right, Anand?
Yes, sir. It was well distended. When we distended, it was distending, sir.
Okay.
So, we relied more on two or three intraoperative findings. One was the distensibility of the stomach. So, it was not like a leather bottle contracted stomach. Number two, although the wall was thick, but when we divided it, when Anand divided it, it was bleeding. So, vascularity was there. And mucosa, we didn't see any active ulceration in the fundus. So we did discuss all these issues during the surgery, whether we should or we should not retain part of the stomach, whether we should do esophago or jejunostomy. But finally, based on these three intraoperative findings, we decided to preserve the fundus and proximal stomach and do a Roux-en-Y gastrojejunostomy.
You can also do a digital examination of the lower esophagus through the stump and see the flexibility and the softness.
Okay, well, patient.
Yes, we mobilized the esophagus also. It was looked.
No, not from outside, from within. Digital.
Doing a per finger.
How easily it dilates onto digital.
Yes, I think that's
good. Very good. Sir.
Yeah, that's a very good practical point.
So can I make a last minute comment?
Yeah, yeah, please go ahead.
Because.
In fact, and how was the stomach mucosa? I mean, was it healthy mucosa or was it cicatrized mucosa?
No, it was not absolutely normal. Yeah. The wall was definitely thick. Yeah.
Second comment is that when we are planning a total gastrectomy, the resident should emphasize whether they want to make a pouch or not.
Yes.
If pouch has to be made, what kind of pouch it has to be, whether it's a proximal pouch, distal pouch, and that knowledge should be there. What are the long term and short term outcome and sequel?
I was about to suggest that if both of you are available and agree, then next Saturday, Bhuvnesh, we can discuss the surgical procedures, not only for corrosive stomach, but corrosive esophagus also, because both these people are experts on esophageal replacement or bypass. So, sir, I will check with you again. Anand will check with both of you again. If both of you are available, then next Saturday, we could discuss the operative procedures in more detail.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
I think we will close because we generally close at 10 only. So, thank you, Dr. Anand Krishnan, sir, for my last minute request accepting it.
Thanks,
and Vikas, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Anand will check with both of you about the next Saturday.
Bye,
Vikas. Anyway, you prepare the operative procedure for corrosive esophagus and corrosive stomach.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Goodbye.
उनको मैंने कल शाम